If I had the choice to bring either my rescue gear or my brain into the backcountry, I'd bring my brain 10 times out of 10 because it's my brain and my knowledge of hazard recognition that's gonna keep me out of trouble in the first place. Well, good thing for us, we can bring good decision-making as well as rescue gear into the backcountry. But remember, owning rescue gear is only a small part of avalanche rescue, and avalanche rescue is an important yet very small part of the avalanche safety puzzle. At the end of the day, rescue gear does not keep you safe, you keep you safe by knowing how to use it and avoiding situations that require it. There's so much new technology that's making mountain rescue more efficient. Some of those new products include avalanche airbags, satellite locators, reco chips, GPS, the list goes on. But those products do not replace the three essential pieces of rescue gear: the avalanche probe, the avalanche shovel, and the avalanche transceiver.
A shovel, a probe, and a transceiver.
Your transceiver, shovel, and a probe.
Transceiver, probe, shovel, right?
Although you buy them separately, think of the transceiver, probe, shovel as a single piece of gear.
These pieces of equipment are only helpful if you know how to use them.
Avalanche transceivers are small electronic devices worn by all members of a team. When traveling, everybody sends out a radio signal. In the event of an avalanche, those not buried switch to search mode and follow the signal towards the buried person.
2, 1.9, 1.8, 1.3, 1.2.
Transceivers have changed dramatically over the past few years, and innovative developments continue to appear. It's also important to know that many electronic devices will actually interfere with transceiver performance. And it's up to you to learn more about how things like cell phones, movie cameras, and other products could affect you in a rescue situation. Three antenna digital transceivers with a visual display and audio speaker define the standard for ease of use, speed, and accuracy.
We can literally run right to that location. Much simpler, much faster.
Transceivers get you close fast, but a probe is how you actually find somebody. Probes are like sectional tent poles that snap together. An assembled probe inserted into the snow in a systematic pattern lets you physically pinpoint someone under the snow so you don't waste time digging.
We can do a lot of digging, and just missing by a little bit means minutes in the dig time. So when we deploy a probe, we just toss it out. We put it together and there's our probe.
A thin diameter probe, often it doesn't go through the avalanche debris itself, or it deflects, or it can even bend. So you want something that's quite sturdy.
Knowing how to assemble it quickly and efficiently. Every probe is made slightly different, but being able to assemble it without having to think about it.
With a shovel, something again with a sturdy shaft and blade, and with a nice handle.
You've got to get a good shovel, otherwise in avalanche snow it's like very condensed. It'll take apart most shovels unless they're a good quality avalanche shovel.
It's also important to think about where we keep rescue gear. Shovels and probes don't do you any good strapped to your sled if you become separated from your machine. Your transceiver should be worn under your jacket, and your probe and shovel belong in your pack.
Having it in a backpack with you, so it's accessible when you need it.
And somebody would be really choked if you were buried and I come running up and said, oh, just a minute, I'm gonna go back and get my shovel and probe and burn up 3 or 4 minutes, and that could be the difference of you surviving or not surviving.
Take the time to learn some basic transceiver skills and you know how to put your probe together, know where your shovel is, and you know, wear your backpacks. You know, you see way too many guys with backpacks strapped on their tunnels, and it's not gonna do you any good if you're not by your sled when you see an accident happen.
What also goes hand in hand with those three pieces of equipment is knowledge. Knowing how to turn your transceiver from send to search, and then knowing how to search with it. Knowing how to assemble your probe without even having to think about it. Knowing how to assemble your shovel and use your shovel effectively.
And almost everyone now is wearing an airbag of some sort. They're proof to help if you are in a bad situation.
It's also worth considering on what side we position our airbag pull cord, knowing that you'll probably want to access a throttle as well as the cord in the event of an avalanche. One thing that is clear when you look at Canadian statistics for avalanche fatalities is that an airbag is not a magic device. You need to know how to set it up, how to deploy it properly, and know its limitations.
and go practice when you're on your sled and you're on a slope, because it's not second nature to go to your pull cord on your airbag.
And yeah, airbags aren't the cheapest, but they last a long time. It's like any of your gear. If you take care of it, it's gonna last. It doesn't wear out the same as a sled or break down the same as a sled does. Putting the investment in those tools and then maintaining them, that equipment can give you a lot of years of service.
Got your shovel, gotta have it. Got your probe, gotta have it. Saw, which is always good to have. I have a little snow study kit, little first aid kit. Big first aid kit like that might not be necessary, but I'd bring something.
Especially if someone's bleeding or something like that, it's pretty essential that you have a first aid kit and a bit of training to help them out.
It's a good idea to get radios so that you can talk to each other.
It makes a huge difference in a group of people to have a radio.
And that way you can keep in touch with each other, so if you do get stuck or you do get lost, you can talk to your buddy on the radio and he can find you, and they're not very expensive.
And then beyond that, you need, you know, some sort of navigation equipment so that you know where you're going.
We talk about even equipment, you need the GPS. If you can be, the more informed a person can be that can run a GPS.
GPS is a fantastic idea. If you need assistance, it really speeds things up if you can tell them where you are with the GPS coordinates.
I've got my InReach device. If I am stuck there or somebody is hurt, there's an SOS button right here which goes straight to search and rescue. For every 10 minutes, it creates a little dot on a map where I am. And it allows you to communicate with anybody, even if you're out of cell phone range.
I carry a spot. I have a satellite phone.
All these devices are is just simply, they're a GPS that activates a satellite system that activates outside help coming in.
Yeah, we all carry Abbey gear. Trying to buy the gear with the Rico tags on them.
It's like a magnetic reflector that's only picked up by a Rico searching device. So it's not to be confused with Avalanche transceivers.
We seem to see a lot of accidents where people call us at 4 o'clock in the afternoon on their cell phone and their parting words are, I'm losing my battery.
To shut it off through the day because it's always looking for a signal.
Cell phone's a great thing to have with you. Make sure it's charged up, but turn it off so you have power when you need it late in the day.
I've got a little bit of extra stuff. My first aid kit, full-on first aid kit. Extra goggles, extra gloves. Extra layers too, base layers. Carry a saw with me if ever I get stuck in a tree. I always have extra granola bars, bottle of water. Got a headlamp. These zip ties, believe it or not, have saved me in so many different ways. Got a hose clamp just in case the hose blows on my sled. Oh, and I've got, it's got some sort of essential oil on it, but if it's soaked in water or snow, it'll still light. So if I'm stuck in the backcountry, sunscreen, Leatherman tool, and then a lighter. So that's kind of basically my essential needs.
You know, if you're willing to spend that much money on a brand new sled or on even a decent used sled, I think it's sort of silly not to be willing to also spend the money on the proper courses and training and equipment that you need to do those things safely.